Hi folks, so I want to give you an introduction into the basics of solar cells and what is required for this solar energy conversion. And I want to make it a very unique, I want to present this introduction in a very unique or a different way as compared to how it's taught in a conventional semiconductor device class or a typical EE class. Or at least I happen to think it's different than how I learned about it the first time. So solar cell, to be very simplistic, it's a device which converts this solar energy coming from sunlight and converts it into something useful that we can used to power our homes and our gadgets and our TVs. And it's a device which essentially converts which achieves this conversion directly. That is, you have a solar cell on which the input is the sunlight and the output is essentially directly electricity. And one can wonder that, is this the really is solar cell the best and the most efficient way to achieve this conversion? Because, all I want is the maximum electricity. So is there a better way? So in fact, there are many different ways. In fact, one way you could convert the sunlight into energy is, you can concentrate this sunlight to a jar full of water. And that would heat up this water and generate steam, and then you can collect this steam and use it to power a turbine, and that would rotate this turbine and then generate electricity. In fact, this is a very valid approach. It's called concentrated solar thermal approach, and shown here is one exemplification of this approach, and it looks like very much a scene that you would expect, a scene picked up from a sci-fi movie, but in fact this is a real installation, and it's a photograph of this installation in the southern part of Spain, in the region of Seville. And it's installed by this company called Abingoa Solar, which is a Spanish company which specializes in this concentrated solar thermal installation. And this is called power tower configuration. And the way it works is that you have these dishes of mirrors, and each of them has a dual tracker. It tracks the position of sun very accurately, and it reflects that sunlight from the sun to this tower. And this tower has essentially this gas turbine, which it heats up, and it has this water circulating here, and this sunlight hitting over here heats up that water, and that essentially generates electricity. So in fact, this is a very valid way to convert sunlight into electricity, and one can debate which one is more efficient. Is this a better approach, or this is a better approach? For the reasons, for the limitations of this, in what we'll study in this class, I want to restrict myself to this particular definition, which is directly converting the sunlight into electricity using these panels of solar cell. And in fact, it's not we can argue about the efficiency, but this definitely seems like something that I can use at my home on my roof. I could have a few of these solar panels as compared to putting up that turbine in my backyard. So again, turning my attention back to the solar cell basics, the way most people think about solar cells and the way it's taught in most of these semiconductor or EE classes is that you know, most common definition is that, you know, you to have this solar cell, you need this PN junction, and then you shine it with sunlight. And many times people actually draw sunlight like this, which is again not true. And then whatever is generated in this depletion region is, you know, these carriers are separated, and you essentially have a PN junction which is reverse biased. And again, the way we understand this solar cell is from this IV characteristic shown over here, where you apply essentially a voltage and you get a reverse current out of it. So your work is being done against, or you are extracting energy out of the cell given by this V into I. And that's the way this PN junction, and this is the way most people get first introduced to solar operation. And while this is, you know, a correct definition, it's a very limited definition of how a solar cell works. And in fact, a lot of solar cells that you'll see being researched on or in the market, they don't look anything like this PN junction. So what I want to do is, you know, dispel this very small definition from your mind and give you what I call as my Big Ten definition of a solar cell. And if you use this definition, you know, you could essentially understand any solar cell available in the market, and what other solar cells which are being researched in universities as well. And it's a very simple definition as well, because, you know, we like simplicity, so it's a very simple definition. And for my definition of solar cell, essentially is that you just need two things to make a solar cell work. And those two things are, you need something which I call as density of state bottleneck. And the other thing which is needed is selective contact. So the other thing you need to make this solar cell work is selective contacts. And by selective, I mean this should be selective, whether it collects electrons or whether it collects holes. So it's selective to either collecting or being conductive to either electrons, at the same time blocking out the holes, or being conductive to holes and blocking out these electrons. And so let's understand, you know, why do we need these two things and how they can make this solar cell work. So the first thing we need is this density of state bottleneck. And what I need by this density of state bottleneck is that you should have a density of state in either your semiconductor or whatever organic material you are planning to use. You should have essentially the density of states, or, you know, the density of available states, that if you plot, essentially, you know, there must be states available above a certain energy level. Let's call it, you know, the conduction band. And then there must be states available below a certain energy level. And just from our semiconductor knowledge, we can call it a valence band. And you have states available below that, but there's essentially a bottleneck. There's a energy space in which your density of state is zero, or in fact your density of state is low. That's a more generic definition. So you have high density of states above a certain energy level. You could either call it a conduction band, or, you know, people who are from the organic world, they call it homol or LUMO. And you have essentially high density of state below this energy level, but you have low density of states, or ideally no density of state, in this region, which is, you know, some people call it the forbidden region, some people call it the band gap. And you know, it's a very simple thing. It's not a very big thing to ask. In fact, most of the semiconductor materials that you have that you most commonly use. For example, you know, this is plotting this energy versus K for these different semiconductors. So this is germanium, this is silicon, and this is gallium arsenide. So for all these semiconductors, you see, you know, that you have states available above a certain energy level. You also have the states available below this energy level, but you don't have states available over here, and that's called as a band gap. And over here also you can see silicon, which is again an indirect band gap material. You have this same density of states being available above the conduction band, below the valence band, but not here. It's gallium arsenide, which is a direct band gap material. Again, you see this density of state bottleneck. So it seems, you know, this is a, you know, a very normal request, and doesn't seem like we might have any problem meeting this density of state requirement.